This is an ESO and Dude Letter production. Welcome to Mission Briefing. Hey everyone, this is Nick talking to you right before Skyfall, man. We're almost through the Bond movies, and it was kind of a neat process, so I hope you enjoyed it. Before we get too far into it, let's talk a little bit about the podcast, man. Depending on how you get this, there's a few ways you can be listening, of course. Either on the website, that will stay the same, or the Myopia podcast feed and the Mission Briefing podcast feed. After Skyfall, we have one more movie, obviously Spectre. And after Spectre, this will be leaving the Myopia feed. We'll do a few other Bond little projects, but they will stay only on the Mission Briefing feed. So hopefully, if you're interested, you can subscribe there. We'll still try to do something about once a month or so, but we'll see. You know, we'll talk kind of wrap-up stuff. We might do another spin-off here or there, all related to James Bond. So I hope you enjoy that. Personally, I have a few plugs. If you're listening to this the day it comes out, we will have the group I'm a part of, Cineprov, will have a performance in Atlanta at the Plaza Theater, riffing on Zardoz. I'm not in this particular episode, or I guess performance. I will be in the next one. But here, you should enjoy it. I think they're a good group. I was helping riff when they were rehearsing, and they really come together. So follow us there. Additionally, if you're not listening to us, if you are listening to us and not following us on Twitter, I'm on Twitter, of course, and in the Facebook group. So please look me up on social media. But without any further ado, please enjoy Skyfall.
Hey everyone, venture into the pop culture cosmos today, where you'll hear our conversations on different topics within the world of movies, TV, video games, comic books, technology, board gaming, and more. You'll also get a taste of some of our other shows within the cosmos as well. So come on and join us each week as we delve into the pop culture cosmos.
Welcome to the pop culture cosmos.
Mission Briefing, we are almost done. I remember Skyfall so good. I remember Adele singing Skyfall. That's good. I almost got it.
Give him a Grammy. Give him a Grammy.
Queen Bee would be so mad.
Oh.
We're talking about whether or not this movie, which I remember liking when it came out, but got some controversy, not necessarily controversy, but this is one of those first movies I remember liking, and people were really unsure whether or not it deserved to be as highly regarded as it was. Daniel Craig at his height, and the end of M, as we've known her since Pierce Brosnan.
Yeah.
But I'm Nick Hoffmann, editor of Dude Letter, and if you guys are listening to this, which you should be, you should also listen to my history podcast associated with Georgia State and Tropics of Meta, Doomed to Repeat. At which point, when this comes out, we should have our third episode and I think three interstitials out. So look up Doomed to Repeat. And on panel with me this time is...
Hello, this is Daniel, and I prefer my beer shaken, not stirred.
This is John.
And Matt.
I don't have anything witty to say.
I don't even think that really counts as witty. That was just the first thing.
It was something.
It was something. I can give you something.
That's all we ask.
He likes the head. A lot of head on his beer.
On his beer, yeah.
So this is embarrassing, but I don't know if this is going to get edited out. Matt, can you introduce yourself again?
Yeah, my name's Matt.
That time you recorded.
I think I had awesome. Your microphone right. turned off. So before we get too far,
did we miss my great beer head joke then?
No, we heard your beer.
Okay,
head.
Phew.
Yes. No, we got to keep that.
Yeah.
That
wouldn't want to lose that.
I want that played at my funeral. That's the way I want to be remembered right there.
Well, so after Matt gives Daniel beer head, we should talk about the cold open. Where everyone apparently dies. That's one of my note. So who wants to start us off? What's the cold open?
Everyone dies?
That's just what I wrote in my notes. I was watching this with Daniel. We weren't really paying attention. No, I'm kidding.
No, we paid
attention. This was Istanbul, right?
They were in Istanbul, yeah. And it's some Bond's on a mission, and he goes to meet his contact or a fellow agent who's been shot and is dying, and
the hard drive's been torn apart. Everyone in the room is dying.
It's the knock list. He apparently had the knock list for all the undercover agents that were embedded in like Al Qaeda and stuff.
Yeah, and it leads to this kind of, well, at this point, the very Daniel Craig scene where he runs across the entirety of a major metropolis swinging from tree to tree like George of the Jungle.
It was an impressive scene, but the Turkish scenes that they did in like actual Istanbul, not Constantinople, were
that's nobody's business but the Turks.
But it's such a bland scene because it's various shades of brown.
I liked it.
I mean, it was entertaining. It was just visually not fun until they got onto the train. I mean,
not every place can be like a beautiful scenic
vista. Well, compare that to later in this movie, Shanghai and Macau, which are fantastic and gorgeously shot.
Yes.
What do you think of London in this movie?
It's London.
Well, or at least he didn't land to London calling. But Daniel and I, when we were talking about this, pointed this out because this is very Sam Mendes versus the previous two directors, because the previous two movies are in very old places. You know, big fight scenes in Siena, Italy. You know, he's in a cathedral. He's running around there. This starts off in a very old looking city and ends up with all glass and metal and like neon. Mm-hmm. Right? It's literally a transition. And it's been a while since we've seen Spectre, but I remember it being a lot the same way. Very lit, like, even in the old buildings, it's like The Spy Who Loved Me, where they're showing laser light shows against the pyramids, right? Yeah. Like, it's designed to make things feel very modern. So we're running through the city of Istanbul, and we have Bond, who's a step behind the eight ball the whole time. He's trying to chase down the person who shot his contact because he has a hard drive that, like Daniel said, is very Mission Impossible 1.
Yeah.
There's a knock list that says all the agents in the field for, I believe, NATO forces.
NATO forces.
Yeah. So it's the CIA wants them dead, too, at this point. Right? I mean,
not
everyone.
When this movie came out, though.
No, but that's the joke, right? Because by the end, M's saying, like, the CIA isn't even talking to us anymore. Like,
we still have a couple friends in the CIA.
Right.
Yeah, that's right.
Which literally means Jeffrey Wright is getting texts constantly from Bond. Bond with little emojis because no one else is talking to him anymore.
What sort of emojis do you think Bond would use?
I don't think he'd use any emojis.
No.
I feel like he's a man of no emojis.
I just picture like this blank face. It's like, how are you feeling, Bond? Non-smiley.
Do you think that's how the casting went? We want someone who would not know how to emote.
That's very
positive. That's him. That's him.
that tickled me.
But they end up on a train.
Well,
and
it's Bond and a fellow operative who, I forget the actress's name, but she was in Moonlight last year. She was.
Yeah, she was in Pirates of the Caribbean.
Right. But what you're talking about is he's still chasing the contact who he saw pull off the shot.
Yes.
And he runs into someone who we find out later is Moneypenny.
Yeah. I think we're just introduced to her as Eve.
That's right. Yeah.
So she's, I guess, the ubiquitous contact in the field.
Mm-hmm.
Who Bond always runs into.
Yep.
And Bond is chasing Patrice, the assassin. They're on top of this train.
I'm remembering, by the way, nice.
I just watched it this morning.
Well,
so
I did
that.
Too, and I couldn't have told you his name.
And Eve is like on a cliff overlooking it, and she says, "I've got a shot. I can take it, but it's not a clean shot."
Well, this is after Bond's like torn up half the train tracks. Mm-hmm. They're like fighting on this roof at 100 miles per hour.
It's fair to skip this sequence.
Yeah, no.
You're right. Yeah.
Well, there's that bit with the crane where he just tears that roof off the train, and then he just jumps out and adjusts his cufflinks. Like, it's no
when
thing.
He lands on the train, lands, adjusts. his cuff, adjusts the lapels and the cufflinks.
It's a very Pierce Brosnan thing, yeah. isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, and...
Oh, and he also gets shot in the shoulder before Moneypenny shoots him, and that actually becomes important, so...
Well, I mean, and Eve, played by Naomi Harris, is the name you're looking for, is... On one hand, the put-upon assistant to Bond, as so many female characters are in the past, but they make an effort to say she can survive on her own, because she's also figuring out a way around the train. They do the stupid fight scene on top of the train, which they rip off directly in Archer, and they're like, why would anyone want to fight on top of a train? There's bugs in your teeth, and all of a sudden, and then they have to both die because a tunnel shows up, which is great, because again, they do it shot for shot in Archer, which is something Archer does very well at this point. But they're on the phone, and literally, Moneypenny is on the phone with M, and she's like, do I take the shot or not? Mm-hmm. And
so I have a question for you.
Sure.
In that scene, when it was Eve talking to M, that kept on cutting to a still image of like some goggles on a table. Oh no, I'm a dumbass. It's a conference phone. Never mind.
So Matt, who is 15 years younger than anyone, this is a conference phone.
It looked like a modern day conference phone, so.
Yes.
I realized it at the very end. I was like, you know what? That's a conference phone. And I forgot that I recognized that. It was dumb for them to show a conference phone static for like 15 seconds on screen.
Now, that is a directing problem. You're right. Because it's not, what they should be showing constantly is either her face or M's face, or her face or M's face. Because the scene ends with her taking the shot, hitting only Bond, Bond falling off of the train into a, like, essentially to the fugitive. He ends up in the fugitive falling 50 feet into the water and then washing down a waterfall.
And I liked the shot where it's like, oh, and he's over the waterfall. Yeah. Like, as if you didn't fall off a bridge. Let's send him off a waterfall, too.
And then he goes from that waterfall into the opening animated sequence.
Yeah. Well, and I want to add this now because it's going to be a runner that I'm afraid we're going to forget. But the maybe B or C plot of this movie is the fact that M is a government employee that may or may not be competent. And this is where that all starts, because we literally see her telling Moneypenny to take the shot. Her face drops when she realizes she's ruined everything, because there's no sound here.
Yeah.
The audio cuts away. Her face drops. We don't even hear any reaction from anyone until it goes into the musical cue. Mm-hmm. But that's kind of an interesting choice for this, because then we get Mallory, who shows up, played by Ralph Fiennes. We don't get like a conspirator. He is someone who believes in the program, but believes that she needs to retire.
Well, he wants her job, and he makes that very clear. It's that sort of a thing.
Well, but he's not wrong. Like, that's why it's interesting. No, like, I mean, it's a C plot. That's an interesting C plot.
Did you say Agent Down before the music happened?
Yes.
She did? Okay.
Yeah. But so we don't.
That was the last thing we heard, essentially.
Right.
Yes. Shot and that. Okay.
But we go to a still background, if I recall correctly. Like, there's not music playing, there's no sound effects. She just says Agent Down, and then we see
him. On the conference phone, we don't even see her.
Yeah. Right. And then we go into Skyfall, the theme. What do you guys think?
I really liked
it. It was good. Yeah. It was very Shirley Bassey.
I remember when they first announced Adele was doing it, and I'm like, huh, that's actually the most appropriate pick they've had in a while.
Yeah. I think last time when we did Quantum, Daniel, you suggested Amy Winehouse.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's what you need, kind of a brassy voice. Not a low voice, but a woman's voice that's kind of brassy.
A Shirley Bassey voice?
Shirley Bassey voice.
A Shirley Bassey
but
voice.
But it keeps it classy.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
This was the 50th anniversary? Was that what this was?
Yes, it was.
Yeah. So and peppered throughout this were all sorts of throwbacks.
Yes.
No. And so to have the main theme in a very Shirley Bassey kind of way makes a lot of sense.
We're going to have to talk about it later. A lot of people gave it flag for all of the throwbacks that were included. I liked them all.
I barely even, they were so like subtle.
Yeah.
Some of them were. Some of them were not. The face, yeah.
But I mean, compared to being like Spectre, Blofeld, and he's raising his eyebrows and like pausing as though we've all heard of it before. That's a little bit more on the nose in the next movie. Here, yes, there's a few, but most of them are much more subtle.
Well, I just think of Die Another Day when they were like throwing a Bond reference in every 5 minutes. And it's like, all right, I get it. You're celebrating your 40th anniversary. Enough.
Right, it was like the 20th movie or something like that.
Well, we can all agree that was a stupid movie and should never be talked of again.
Yes.
I mean, and like...
You want to talk about it, obvious. That was the movie they did right before they did Johnny English. So, yeah. Like, come on, guys.
There's the cue sequence in Die Another Day where he has the tracking shotguns on the car and he shoots right through the manual. That's actually one of my favorite cue scenes. I love that cue scene.
Well, I mean, and this cue we'll talk about, but like we're reintroduced to the whole cast of characters in this movie, which I kind of like. I don't know.
I like this cue. He's different.
Well, and
I like him too, and I remember liking him a lot in Spectre. So
I do too. I mean, he's also someone in the field, which is something we'll get to, that everyone has to be a part of the field. Because, I mean, frankly, Dame Judi Dench is like a third build in this movie after Javier Bardem.
I mean,
like, she pulls her weight in this, because this is effectively, it's like watching Batman Returns again, where it's like a Batman movie without Batman. This is almost a Bond movie without Bond, because she's the most important second character. He drives the plot. She's the one that we want.
Well, we've seen this coming for a while now, haven't we? Like, Die Another Day was almost entirely about her, and they've done a lot in the last...
I thought you said we weren't supposed to speak of that movie again.
not Die Another Day. The World Is Not Enough. The good one. Better one.
The better
one. That we've seen, at least over the Pierce Brosnan movies, that M has become an actual character, whereas in the previous Bond movies with like Bernard Lee, M was just the Bosley character to give the mission, and that was it.
Yeah.
Whereas Judi Dench made it a character, which Ralph Fiennes seems to be picking up.
Well, and what's interesting here is, in many ways, Ralph Fiennes' character is more modeled on a Bernard Lee.
Definitely aesthetic. Well,
the end of this movie really is a callback, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, he even has the goddamn leather door.
All he needed was to throw a hat onto the...
not to jump
away. There's even a coat rack.
Yeah, there's a coat rack, but he doesn't toss the hat.
I loved the padded leather door.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, this is so comfortable.
I need a study with a leather door,
And the banter with the money penny. Yeah.
I do like this money penny. I really do. And I mean, it's funny because I really like Samantha Bond. It's a shame she got kind of short shafted. Mm-hmm.
But she was good.
She was good. But I mean, Naomi Harris here.
And with a name like Bond, I mean, she was she was suited for it.
Can you imagine showing up to the audition and handing across your headshots and it says Bond? And it's like,
Bond, Samantha Bond.
All right, we're about that time. John, would you like to give us our plot synopses?
So, short answer is they're all after this list. And Bond is trying to track down this assassin. Well, let me back up. Bond goes dead for 3 months. Because he thinks this is a good time to die. They've already shot me. I need to recuperate. I'll just go off the grid for a bit. He disappears. Meanwhile, all hell is breaking loose while the intelligence agencies are trying to track down this list. And M is being raked over the fire with Ralph Fiennes and then the civilian government in England saying, how could you cock this up so badly? You need to go. And more importantly, the intelligence industry in Britain needs to be redone or re-looked at. So there's a lot of moving parts to it. Then on CNN... Bond sees Wolf Blitzer says on CNN, breaking news, the first five names of this missing list have been released. And Bond realizes he has to come back in and finish what he started and get the list.
Mm-hmm. Well, and we should kind of stop here for 1 second. This is the most on the nose since possibly Volcano, where it was just a bunch of news reporters actually doing the reports. But like, this scene reminded me so much of Jurassic Park. You see M in like a nightgown and like a robe, and she pulls up her laptop and a pop-up ad comes up, and it's practically like, you know, Dennis Nedry going and it just starts showing this YouTube clip of person's face, person in the field, person's, and it's, again, on one hand, it is literally a very, we'll get to this because this is Daniel's point, so I'll give it to him, but very Dark Knight.
Yeah.
This is a very Joker kind of, we're going to screw you and we're going to make it slow. Phrasing. but, you know, this is literally her worst nightmare, and it's presented in a very cartoony way. Because literally...
With the whole think on your sins bit, too, at the end.
Mm-hmm. Think on your sins. And it's a YouTube playlist with a bunch of question marks as things are going to be released over the next, whatever, one a day for the next blankety-blank days, as he reveals secret agent after secret agent, because, like you referenced, Wolf Blitzer is literally showing a clip where someone who is embedded somewhere in Africa is literally being gutted.
Yeah.
Like,
which even CNN, I think, would not air something like that. Maybe Fox, but not CNN.
Actually,
Well, no, Fox would air it and then ask, is this Obama's fault?
CNN did cover the Malaysian Airlines thing for like a solid 2 months.
Yes. Oh, I was going
to
say.
Of all the horses to pick, they picked that one.
they would pretend like it was an accident that they actually showed the gutting, you know, kind of like in the 1970s.
Sorry, it was an intern. Yeah.
Oh, no, we didn't. Oh, well, it's still on.
We'll just pay the fine to the FCC and move on.
Elbow. Look at these ratings. But yeah, that's kind of what it is. And it's bleak. Like, this is very interesting because Bond feels, well,
he feels the need to come back into the fray, basically.
Right. And this is one of these things where we get him really feeling for Queen and Country, mm-hmm. right? Which is kind of the thing, like, because he re-enters the field, he comes back and he makes himself known to M in an excellent scene, because it's essentially a scene that both Pierce and Sean Connery did, where he's drinking in a place where he shouldn't be, waiting for the gavel to fall, right?
Oh, with that hammer. That cool little trick where he's got the scorpion on his arm where...
That's not what I'm talking about.
Oh.
That's where we're introduced to the fact that he's not dead. He has sex with a woman like he does. A woman who never gets a line, disappears from the movie immediately, but he goes to his bar. That's where he sees CNN.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But there's this game where if he moves too quickly, of course, the scorpion will sting him, but he has to finish a shot of whiskey, throws it down, tosses off the scorpion, etc. But I was talking about when he shows up in M's apartment.
Ah, yeah.
And she sees him in the shadows and goes to 007, I guess you're not dead. I wrote your obituary. He goes, I know, I read it. Wasn't very good.
That's right.
It's a good line.
Yeah. But this is where we also introduced that M's husband, who we've kind of seen in the background in some of these movies, he's dead. She's home alone.
Yes.
She's by herself. And I guess vulnerable.
Yeah. Well, and she's made all the more vulnerable, which I think is either in the next scene or the scene before when she's going to the headquarters. Six. And the headquarters explodes.
Yeah.
We're forgetting, I hate to jump back, we're forgetting M's best line when Bond comes back to her penthouse and he's like going, we sold all of your property and the flat that you lived in. And then Bond's like, all right, I'll find a hotel. And M just goes, well, you're bloody well not sleeping here.
Yeah, that's funny. Mm-hmm.
She's snarky.
She is.
Yeah.
And Bond is quickly into the realization that he was dead. He no longer has a home, which kind of goes in with what we see in Spectre, where we finally see Bond's home, mm-hmm. which isn't the Roger Moore courtly estate kind of thing, but it's an empty apartment.
Why would Bond have a mansion? He'd barely be there.
No, exactly. That's what we see.
In Spectre, we see an apartment where everything is still in its boxes. Right. There's no furnishings. It's just a place where he occasionally sleeps. But we do see his rental garage.
We do.
Yes.
Where he keeps the DB5.
Oh, that's so cute.
Which is oddly tricked out. Like it was back in the Sean Connery, Roger Moore.
I think it's supposed to be the same one.
The timeline doesn't quite fit because he won it in the first one in Casino Royale.
Don't worry about it. It's fine.
It's got the ejector seat, which make painfully obvious. It's got the machine guns and the lights, which is still cool.
Well, right. But I mean,
that's jumping ahead.
Well, no. I like that scene. I like that scene a lot. A, because the idea is this is very practical technology, right? Because mm-hmm. Bond is talking about, because later he even has this little, like, it's designed to look like a little lighter, like a little Zippo.
The radio.
That has a radio in it. Mm-hmm. The rest of this is very practical. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've been in Atlanta traffic. I wish I had a machine gun too when someone cut me off.
And sometimes an ejector seat.
Right. Yeah. But this is very, but that's what that is. Mm-hmm. And they destroy it at the end, which is sad.
Yeah.
I guess spoilers.
But to his point, it's like all the company cars have trackers in them. Right. And this is a guy who uses their own surveillance against them. Mm-hmm. So you need something off the grid.
Well, I mean,
which even M points out is like, this is a most uncomfortable car. How could you do this?
Because they drove up the Scottish Highlands, which must be a very uncomfortable. Like, it's a Top Gear ride that puts Jeremy Clarkson into traction. But I mean, we also have to remember that when she arrives at the apartment is from being chewed out by Mallory, and that's Ruby Fiennes' character. And so, mm-hmm.
Well, Mallory's flat out said your butt's going to get fired
for this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
because he essentially says you need to retire at the end of your whatever term. I forget the term he uses, mm-hmm. but he says in 2 months, mm-hmm. and she goes, I'm going to leave. Well, I mean, I have the line. I wrote it down. But he goes, I know I can't have this job forever, but I'll be damned if I'm going to leave it in worse condition than when I got it. Mm. And he goes, Em, you've had a good run. You should leave with dignity. She goes, to hell with dignity. I'll leave when the job's done, which is a great line.
Yeah.
I mean, well, again, so rarely is Em given any characteristics. Dame Judi Dench deserves to have some character.
Yeah.
She gets it. I'm very happy with this character because, again, Bond is the least important character at times in this movie, mm-hmm. Other than to drive the plot along, because it's one of the few where M keeps saying, can you leave anyone alive? Like, literally anyone. We need information. Can you leave anyone alive? And even the women he accidentally runs into, who he promises to save, end up dying in this movie.
Yes.
Yeah, well, there's not even really a Bond girl in this movie, except for that one woman that eventually leads him to Silva, whom he kills. Not Bond, Silva kills her, and that's it.
Yeah.
Which is a good scene.
Which is a very good scene. Yeah. So we should eventually get there.
One day.
You wanna advance this?
Where were we?
Okay, so Bond comes out.
Yeah, so he sent out to Shanghai.
He first has to qualify.
Yes. Right. Oh, true.
And since MI6 headquarters has been blown up, they're all in Churchill's old bunkers under London.
Which is the new layer.
Yes. Yeah.
Which I only mention for because it comes important later, but he has to qualify a psych evaluation, he has to requalify on his shooting skills. He has to be, and he is clearly in a lot of pain.
Yeah.
He can't shoot for shit. He is mentally ill. They do a word association thing out of a montage from a police academy movie. It's ridiculous.
But to that, they mention Skyfall.
They do.
The psychologist is like, England, what do you think of? Employment, you know, murder, death, whatever. But then he says Skyfall.
Yeah.
And Bond pauses. And then walks out of the room.
Yes.
He says done.
Done. Yeah. And then walks out of the room. But we're never told why Skyfall is mentioned, what the connection is. We find out later what it is.
Yes.
But we never figure out why that they decided to throw that in, other than to keep the audience engaged.
I mean, they do reference it specifically when they were talking, when Silva pulls up his files and it's like, you know, childhood trauma, blah, 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 blah.
Well, I mean, so it's make sure he's fit for duty. Yeah, I mean, if he's freaking out over a childhood trauma, then you don't send him to the field.
Which is something we find out, which is important. I mean, like, that's why I bring it up, because Bond is literally the worst candidate for everything. Like,
other than he's, you know, the best
especially
agent,
now. But. Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
because now he's the best agent, but he's injured.
Yeah. Well, and if this is Bond's origin story, which it kind of starts with Casino Royale, like it's his first double O mission, which we see, he is physically incapable of even doing pull-ups anymore. Like, which is actually a very well done scene as an actor, because he's doing pull-ups, and the whole time, what's his name? Is
Tanner.
Tanner is barking questions, and he balks at a question, and Tanner can be like, we'll come back to this. At which point, Bond literally collapses against the bar. Like, he is not only exhausted, but wounded. To the next scene where he's literally taking out, like, a Leatherman to the sound of, like, I don't know, Black Hole Sun and picking out chunks out of his chest.
Oh, yeah.
Mm. I like that he hadn't done that yet because he knew it was evidence.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's a bullet wound that he got in the opening train scene, everybody, when the person he was chasing shot him in the shoulder.
Which is just, it's something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And Tanner's like holding this like baggie. It's well done.
Well, that's how he ends up in Shanghai, though, right? They analyze the ball, and it's like only a certain number of people
use like uranium-tipped ammunition.
Yeah, depleted uranium ammunition, which makes no sense. I mean, yeah, it's dense. Why use it with a handgun, though? Use a regular bullet.
Mm-hmm. Well, right, but it's something that the U.S. military uses, which
for larger caliber rounds.
Right, but that's what I'm saying.
Handgun rounds.
That's what I'm talking about. Like, it's used for like anti-tank weapons, and it's used for large caliber automatic weapons. It's not used for just like
a pistol.
Which is why only three people in the world do it.
Because it's stupid.
A small automatic
pistol. And then Bond plays a round of Guess Who with him. Why is that one?
It's one of these three.
It was like the guy who shot him, a black guy, and a guy, in, I don't know, a Hispanic guy. And he's like, why, it's the one bearded white guy. Thank you. Thanks, Q, or whatever.
So we know he's on his way out to find Patrice, the assassin.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And he's sent to meet up with Q Branch.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the new, younger, fitter Q meets up with him in the art gallery.
This is one of my favorite scenes, man.
And Bond just takes him to task, saying, you're too young to do this. You've still got spots in your face. Why should I pay attention to you?
And well, I mean, it's even better than that, because he's sitting down, like, Bond sits down at the, I mean, it's like any Bond scene, right? He's like, he meets at this certain location, waiting for the person to say the right words. And Q makes small talk. And if you've looked at our page, you know that he looks exactly like Perini. But they're looking at a very famous Turner painting, one I like very much. And they're talking about how, you know, the sea always does this and this to me. And Bond's like, excuse me. And he gets up to leave and he goes, hello, 007. And he goes, God damn it. Yep. This kid, really?
Really?
This child. And he's like wearing, you know, a tie and a vest, but it's like under a polo, a hoodie or something.
He looks like an extra from The Big Bang Theory.
He does.
Yeah.
Or just he looks like a young professor. Mm-hmm. You know, someone who's just trying to be cool. Yeah. I would know nothing about
that. He's not
that.
Quite hipster level, but he's definite more mod than Q ever was.
Because he's English.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you know, it's one of these things and like you said, it's interesting because when we are introduced to Q back in the 60s, we understand that they have a relationship. He's the new quartermaster, right? Mm-hmm. Here, Bond vets him in his own way, which I kind of like, you know, because he is someone who's clearly at least 15 years younger than Daniel Craig. And so when Bond challenges him, he feels like if this kid doesn't play toe-to-toe with me, he'll play toe-to-toe with me. And he does. He mm-hmm. comes right back at him. I think the line is something, I don't have this one in front of me, so I'll get it wrong, but Bond goes, youth does not mean innovation. And the kid goes, but experience is not necessarily
skill. Well, old age isn't necessarily experience, I think.
Exactly mm-hmm. right. And Bond smiles back at him and then takes his mission.
Mm-hmm. And he takes the gadgets, which I loved for their simplicity. They really fit with the well, Daniel Craig era.
They managed to get two of the references into this like 10-second bit, first with the handprint gun, which is Licensed to Kill, and then after he gets it, it's like, is that all? It's like, what were you expecting, an exploding pen? Which is, I don't know why they made that dig at GoldenEye.
We don't do that anymore.
Yeah. Well, but to be fair, the same director directed the first of his series, right? Mm-hmm. Martin Campbell? Yeah, so it might just be a kind of like, Martin could have done this one too.
I really liked the little radio transmitter. It was very, I think it was Goldfinger, where they had the shoe one.
Yeah,
liked it.
That's
little
right.
thing stuck in his shoe. I liked it.
Oh, yeah. So that's not where he like sticks it on a Goldfinger's bumper.
Yes.
They're throwbacks, but at the same time, it's simple.
Yeah, it's very
simple. It's almost like From Russia with Love, where he's given a briefcase with a knife and some coins in it. And Bond is given a gun. Okay, it has like a handprint analyzer, but it's a gun and a radio. That's it. There's no exploding stuff. There's no
and both
magic
actually
material.
Become important.
Well, and I mean, to Daniel's point, which again I referenced, but he hasn't yet, so I'll let you talk on it later. but this is where Dark Knight differs, right? Because Batman in Dark Knight has million-de-billion gadgets, but Bond is very on his own. He's very practical. He's very nose to the grindstone, which if you talk to comic book nerds, which I pretend to be because they pay me to, but you know, Batman is supposed to be a what they call ground level superhero, unless he's, you know, flying in a space shuttle off to Justice League. But the idea is that he's supposed to be dealing with his neighborhood in Gotham on the ground. This is what Bond is. He's literally figuring out who Silva is. He's ending up in this casino in Macau, which is where we're about to jump to, because he just is Bond figuring shit out. He doesn't have a Batmobile. He doesn't even have a car in this movie other than a 1960s, which gets turned into dust, which is the saddest
scene. I love that scene because like that's when he loses it. Like car blows up and he just cuts to him and he's like,
Well, I mean, literally the music falls away and they cut to him and they cut to the fire and they cut to him and they cut to the fire and we're all screaming.
And it wasn't even over the top, but like, because there's probably like a 3-second shot of him where it's just like him looking at his beautiful car that's just been blown up.
And you know, like in the movie theater, you could hear everyone just going, no.
He's more broken up about it than his whole house turning to dust.
He said he hated the house.
I hate this house.
He hates that house.
There's nothing left. Oh my god.
KQ Shanghai.
Yeah. Shanghai was gorgeous. I loved that scene.
It was a Blade Runner scene.
It was all neon lit.
And unfortunately, isn't it Dark Knight too when they steal the mafia guy?
Yeah, they go to Hong Kong, I think.
Hong Kong.
Yeah.
This one's so much more memorable than that though.
Yeah.
Oh no, it is because everyone remembers the Joker, but Batman does extradite again.
Yeah, for no reason.
Well, because he was laundering money for the mob.
He could do that anywhere.
Falcone?
He could do that literally anywhere. He had to go to Hong Kong to do that?
Well, that he could avoid Gotham's law enforcement. And
just like he avoided Hong Kong law enforcement?
He did. That was the thing, because he was rich and bribed everybody.
God.
It made sense,
anyway,
John.
Shanghai. To moving to a good movie.
oh! Shots fired, John.
So he waits for Patrice because they magically figured out where Patrice the assassin was going to be. He's a chauffeur or something at the airport. Patrice shows up and drives off. Bond follows him. They go up into an empty skyscraper for some reason.
Yeah, like under construction building.
Yeah. Again, gorgeous views of Shanghai and amazing shots. Bond gets to Patrice after Patrice kills someone in the building across the street.
I thought this was strange. Like, he had the opportunity to stop him.
Yes.
And he doesn't?
Yep. Well, why would he necessarily?
He
I mean, it's not important for him to necessarily stop Patrice from killing that guy.
His mission is to get Patrice to tell him where the list is.
I just think it lays out, like, it struck me, having, I mean, I had seen it before, but it was like, he could have stopped him.
Yeah, no,
the
I,
point
I agree.
Is, we're supposed to be curious about the people across the street who don't react when the guy is killed.
I actually liked that a lot. Like, he was sitting in front of
Bond,
the
because Bond sees that too, he's like, that's weird.
Yeah.
And he sees the woman in it who comes back in Macau.
Yeah. And I mean, it's interesting because not only, yes, I was wondering the same question Matt was, but also I noticed that a bunch of people did not react.
Yes.
That was because when I first saw it, I was more impressed because, again, it's a scene out of Blade Runner where they're in a glass building and it's almost like a house of mirrors out of something like Man with the Golden Gun, where everything's flashing around, and then a bunch of neon lights appear behind them. It's a very pretty scene. But a whole bunch of nonsense happens in between because it's one of the few times we are reminded that Bond is wounded. When we did, is it The World Is Not Enough? No, it's Die Another Day, where after the torture scene in North Korea, there's like 6 seconds where we pretend Pierce Brosnan is wounded, but then he's just fine.
And he's fine.
Yeah.
But
he shares
here,
and he's fine.
Bond reaches down to grab the assassin because, again, M's like, can you please not kill one person so we can get information? But his he grabs with the wrong arm, which is the wounded arm, so he can't hold on, so the guy falls 75 stories.
I liked the thud off of the building out into space. He's like, ugh.
I was listening to it with subtitles on, and they had the thud.
Nice.
I really liked just one part of this fight choreography where it's a quick shot, but Bond falls out the window, grabs the gun, pulls himself back.
On
the building.
That's really cool.
Yeah, that was cool.
The fight choreographer nailed everything about this movie.
And it was shot well, too. It was like all one unbroken shot. They're like backlit against the neon sign on the other building.
Just a gorgeous, well-done scene.
Yeah.
Well, and again, I don't like American Beauty at all, but Sam Mendes has a thing for colors, and he's very good with colors.
I didn't put that together. That's the same guy.
Same guy.
Okay.
That's why it took 45 years to come out with the next movie. And
what, Road to Perdition?
No, I meant Spectre. But it just...
That could be a bomb.
Sam Mendes did a great job. So, I guess Terry Gilliam for the next movie? He's done.
Done with Don Quixote.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
Well, it would take... What would happen if Terry Gilliam shot a Bond movie?
Oh, he would be drugged a lot more. There'd be a lot more colorful images. Mm-hmm. He should only direct the music video part at the beginning.
Oh, there you go.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, my God.
That would be fantastic.
Yeah. So, regardless.
Yeah.
So this is in Macau.
Yeah, in the assassin's case, he finds like a poker chit. And it's, I guess, to this particular Macau poker house.
Casino.
So, thank you.
Yeah. The
words,
poker house.
Words.
Well, you just went for the vernacular. John was going for the official term of poker house.
Poker house. And so he's in Macau in just another gorgeous scene with, like, lanterns all over the place. And he shows up in a boat.
And Moneypenny shaves him. Before we get
that's
there.
That's right, yes. Yeah. And which is okay.
Which is a very something scene.
Well, the scene...
We don't know she's Moneypenny yet.
No, but it's one of these scenes that... I like the
I liked him with a beard.
Oh, I liked him with the beard, Scruff. But I was thinking about the old Bonds where there's a chemistry between them that we don't understand, but the idea of them hooking up once maybe
before
makes
it becomes
more
a,
sense.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
I don't know if they ended up... doing it.
It is heavily implied.
It's implied, but
we never see
moving
it.
Moving forward,
it's not.
But backward, it's implied that they never have been together.
But they've been romantic. Mm. And right, well, that there was like a connection, but it,
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, because it's an, she's the agent in the field that meets him. She's not the Bond girl. She doesn't show up in, like, bed with him.
More often than not, those two are the same thing. Yeah.
But we don't see it. We always see them every other time. Literally any other time we would see them, at least him getting up mostly naked out of a bed, right? But she shaves him because he's having trouble because of his injury. But the next shot is...
Well, he unbuttons her top. And she says, like, let's finish this first. And she finishes shaving him, doesn't she?
Yeah, she has eyes up here. It's,
yeah, this is the tough bit. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then they're cut to her in a new dress and him in a new in a tux, standing up on a dragon boat, riding through the mouth of a dragon, which is a fucking glorious show.
That's a good show.
Yeah.
If I ever look that cool once, the best I got is being a groomsman at Matt's wedding, where I look like his dad or his uncle, looking down at him, kind of smiling.
That's a good show.
Yeah. I at least look not drunk, which is a lot of my pictures. But I mean, it's just like, he's like, I'm guiding this boat by my sheer source of will. Like, he looks like almost like Professor X or something. Like, but regardless, they end up at this casino with an earpiece in, and Bond is literally giving her spy advice the whole time.
Don't touch your ear.
Which was a Casino Royale reference.
But when Daniel and I were watching this, this sequence is amazing. It's not only one continuous shot by Mendez, but literally she gets up when he comes in so they don't look like they're connected. They're talking the whole time, and then they cross paths again, and the microphones switch. So you hear it from in his ear like a radio mic, which if you're on mic, it'll sound like this. You're like here right now. Be quiet. Be quiet. Be good. Like, now don't look left. Don't look right. But then it goes, when you hear the switch, they switch the microphone so it sounds like you hear them in person, then back to the earshot. Brilliantly audio choreographed to then him turning in the chip, which draws attention to everyone. Because she's supposed to be subtle, and he's like, don't touch your ear. We want you to be completely anonymous.
Yeah.
This is when he starts to become Bond, because Bond is a renegade to being the Bond in every other Bond movie who's in charge of every element. That's why he doesn't need Q. That's why he doesn't need M. Here he needs everyone to being in charge.
Well, I think, and we haven't mentioned this theme at all yet, but whether or not human intelligence is valuable comes up a lot in this movie. And I think that this scene is like, wow, he's really good at this. You can't do this remotely. You can't do this from a computer. You need like boots on the ground and someone that's trained to do this. Just because they make a point of it a couple times, like
I think even Q said, like, sometimes you need a trigger.
Yeah.
It's
Well, I mean, and that's the difference. Like, because I think the exact line is someone needs to pull the trigger. Or, that's why we need you. And then Bond goes, and then not to pull the trigger.
Yeah,
That was
which
a great
is
line.
If this is what year did this come out?
2012.
2012. That's an Obama joke.
Yeah.
Because this is the drone era, right?
Oh,
Right, and this is when Bond's like, sometimes you don't need to pull. You don't need to launch the missile, right? Which has nothing to do with the current era.
Yeah, rely on the Komodo dragons to, take down the henchmen.
Which, of course, as soon as they're introduced, you knew that shit was going to go down. Someone was going to get in.
Fuck.
So he exchanged the chit. He gets,
$1 billion.
A billion Macau coins or whatever they're called.
Monopoly money.
And... Yeah. The woman and the henchman from the other building meet him, and Bond and her have a cordial, typical Bond thing where they're having drinks at the bar, very tense because he's figuring you're going to kill me at any moment. But then the tables are turned when he realizes the henchmen are not protecting her.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
They're keeping her captive.
Yeah.
Doesn't it imply she's been like a sex slave since she was 12
That's
or something?
Yeah, because she has a tattoo or something on her that says Macau sex trade, whatever.
Yeah.
And she said,
spelled right out there.
Well, somehow he knew that in typical Bondism.
Yes.
Oh, you're a lepidopterist now. Yeah. And she tells him that, my benefactor is, he's been good to me, but he's a really bad guy.
Yeah.
And Bond says, take me to him, essentially.
Yeah.
And she says, meet me on this boat tomorrow morning if you're still alive. She walks out and the heavies move in.
Now, yeah. I don't see Silva. Now that we're talking about this, I don't see Silva having a hand in the Macau sex trade.
I don't think he is. I think it's a boss of a boss kind of a thing.
Okay. Yeah.
You know, it's like there's the five families of Chicago and someone takes over. I think someone has a bid because when we get to Silva, he says that the event with M happens in like 97 or 98. Well,
it was when Hong Kong was handed back to China.
Yeah.
Right, which is... Well, something Bond
which was, I think, 99.
Like, Tomorrow Never Dies. Yeah. Yeah. And so, like, that's the thing, right? I think that Silva is just... Here's one of the problems that we'll talk about when we get to Spectre, but Spectre tries to back color all these things. Mm-hmm. Who knows what Sam Mendes and the 9,000 writers who worked on this, right? But this might be one of those things where they're like, if we leave enough things vague, we might be able to do something.
Well, it implies when we meet Silva that he's connected to all sorts of organized crime syndicates through that giant server that he's built on that island.
Yeah, more or less.
Yeah.
Which, as far as layers go, is pretty cool. Because he makes some note that it's a built-up island. It was a city or a town or something on it. Mm-hmm. Maybe even a fortress. And he says, I just spread the news that there was a outbreak of X.
There was a chemical.
And people just disappeared overnight. And they left all their stuff behind. And it's mine now.
It's very, it feels like a very Pierce Brosnan just after the Cold War kind of thing. Like, you know, he could do it the same in Cypriot after Chernobyl, you know, just kind of like this abandoned, horrifying town. And he uses it to good effect. There's even like kind of post-communist imagery of giant statues and hands.
Yeah, I was going to say, especially during the scene with the dueling pistols.
It's this kind of like this idea of what megalomaniacy can do in this world where, I will say, this is the era of the beginning of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It reminds me a lot of one of the Iron Man kind of like, this is the power of capitalism thing, but they don't necessarily go there because even Dark Knight goes there, which again, I've talked about more than Daniel because he put it in my little head. I'm so much less impressionable until Daniel says something, but that's why I like John.
Duly noted.
Because he makes me funny. but I mean, like, again, the idea of Joker standing on the pile of money burning two-thirds of it because he doesn't care about money. This is that. This is like, look, I can do whatever I want. Markets don't matter. Because even at the later when we see Silva, Silva's like, look, with three keystrokes, I can destroy an entire market. But I want him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's about revenge. It's not about the money. It's about revenge. This is that's literally the Joker. This is where you get the closest to being right about anything, Daniel.
Thank you.
But it does go back to your points that this is kind of redux of The Dark Knight.
Well, it's several things with Silva, and I assume we've already gotten to his introduction. He's on the private island that Bond gets taken to.
We haven't talked about it, but he's there.
Yeah, he's there.
I liked the introduction. I think that shot with him walking from the elevator.
Yeah, it was a long
talking
shot.
Talking to the story about the rats on the island.
Yeah.
Now they only eat rat.
Yep, and they're two rats.
Because every good villain has an allegory.
Yeah.
Yes.
I liked that scene a lot. Like, and he gets like two rats left, and it's like two shot of him and Bond.
Yeah.
Well, and not only is it a two shot of him and Bond, it's a two shot of him after making the grand entrance. Bond being tied to the chair, and he's like, no, we're equals. You uncuff him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, there's that weird sexual advance, but it's not a sex, which we can get to in a second.
It is a sexual advance.
Yeah, it is.
Well, right, but after that, the sexual advance goes away. It's not like he's hitting on Bond constantly. It's more like seeing his limits. However, it's more like, we're equals. Let's see where that line is drawn. And for Bond, it's not that you can't upset me. You're the villain, I'm the hero. And then Silva goes, why am I the villain? Which is a powerful scene. Like, it's also a scene where if it was a Pierce Brosnan or Sean Connery, he'd be offering him a glass of you know, a whiskey or a brandy or a
to be fair, he does offer him a whiskey. So.
He does, but he doesn't take it. This is not a scene where they're toe-to-toe. This isn't a standard, like, now tell me your plot. You know, right?
Yeah.
Well, he doesn't invite Bond to join him because he says, you've been wronged by M, I've been wronged by M, let's team up because I'm the tech guy, you're the trigger, we can do this.
This is where someone read like the Cliff's Notes version of Freud and just started masturbating furiously.
Yeah.
This is literally the most like, or Romulus and Remus, like they're these two brothers that are under the wolf mother and like one got treated better than the other and one gets Rome named after him and one just dies in a fire. Like this is...
It was a little different, but okay, sure.
One is Romulus for Rome and one is not.
Because he was a dick and he jumped through the wall that Romulus was building.
Which is Silva.
Yes.
Which is Silva.
Silva. But regardless, like, Silva even shows up in a white suit when Bond is wearing a black suit. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that white jacket, that actually looked pretty cool.
And I even made the reference to Daniel when we were watching it. It's a Clint Eastwood movie because when MI6 blows up, right? Mm-hmm. There's this row of coffins that we come out to, which is all the British flag, Jack. And M is looking onto it mournfully as like, you know, you have these information coming in the side and she's almost like, give me 1 second to mourn. This is another like very like man in the black hat versus the man in the white hat, like Clint Eastwood kind of scene where he comes down in the elevator like a Bond villain, but they sit inches apart as he feels up his leg. It's just, and it's a blonde guy versus a brunette guy. It's like literally color opposites.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I like this very much.
It's fun. And we're introduced to Silva in a fun way. And he plays this game with Bond. He's tied up the girl outside in this, you know, statue park, whatever. Puts a shot glass on her head. Hands out dueling pistols and says to Bond, first one to knock the glass over wins.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We think Bond is going to, you know...
Bond does the thing.
He does his thing, we think, but his arm is obviously troubling
him. I thought he did pretty well for a dueling pistol.
Oh, it was fantastic. Yeah. He played the game as it was supposed to be played, where he hits the statue just behind her head.
Yeah.
Whereas Silva just takes aim, shoots her like in the stomach or the head or something.
I saw it and he's just like, because there's not even a pause, he's just like, my turn, bam.
Bam. And you see the shot glass hit the ground.
I win.
Do you remember Bond's And then, but do you remember Bond's response?
No, I did not.
It's a waste of a good scot.
Oh, yeah.
A waste of a good scot.
And then, he starts beating up the heavies.
Yeah.
It's like a Glenclaren 50 or something.
Something like
50
that.
50-year-old scotch. Yeah.
Now, I have a question for the three of you, because I like you and you're all brunettes like I am. Mm. Is this a better introduction to an equivalent MI5 agent, MI6 agent, as Trevelyan?
I like this more.
Yeah, I think this works
because
more.
Because it's very similar even, because they're in a statue garden, right?
That's true. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because, like...
I think that this character, like, he's much more believably corrupted, I guess.
Yeah.
Trevelyan, I don't know. I liked Trevelyan a lot, obviously.
Sure. But.
Yeah, well,
I'm with you on that. I think that this worked a lot better because it actually does establish Bond being scared of him because Silva's got the same skills that he does. And Goldeneye, he was just more, oh, wait, this guy's still alive? Thematically, it was better.
And Trevelyan had obviously turned to a life of crime, but we're not entirely sure what Silva was after or doing during all this time. We don't know if he was specifically manipulating all these things or if he just had that end result of let's get M.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And well, he's got the brutality that Trevelyan just never really had. He was too smarmy.
Yeah, I mean, I like Trevelyan's introduction at the very beginning that he is someone Bond knows, and I like the reveal that Bond is actually shocked, right? Like in Trevelyan.
Yes.
But I do like the brutality because, like, again, the problem with Trevelyan is that there's no revenge element, right? This is literally like, because I understand why Silva's pissed. I understand, especially in the when he's essentially in a very Batman-like.
Yeah.
Prison where he takes out the jaw and there's nothing like I tried to kill myself, but I couldn't die because and then the god said I must get revenge on you. Like,
no.
I understand that turn as well. But for the rest of us, however, Trevelyan just seems above it. I think the problem is Silva's much creepier as a villain because he's made much more human. Trevelyan's almost
the last boss. Mm-hmm. His revenge plot for Silva was very cut and dry. For Trevelyan, it was like the Lyons Cossack Rebellion. Right,
against the Russians, and then the English.
Say a couple plot exposition things, and now he's evil.
Like, if GoldenEye had been simply, you set the bombs off too soon, I'm going to get revenge on you.
Yes.
That would have been a simpler plot, very similar to this. But instead, it was this whole nationalities and my father's father's father and things like that.
Well, I mean, frankly, it's why Christoph Waltz is more interesting in some ways, even though we'll get to that movie when we get to it next. But he's like, I'm your brother and you've effectively betrayed me. That's much, in some ways, more interesting because it's almost more Oedipal. Like, the thing is, by the end of this movie, it is very much like M is both of our mothers because you, Bond, both of your parents died, and she was, I looked up to her like she was my maternal figure. She betrayed both of us. Will you join me or not? Inspector, they're literally brothers, and it's one of the few times where Bond's like, I thought you died, but you didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Well, fuck.
And we'll get to that disappointing plot point later.
Yeah.
I think we're all very divided on that one because I think it kind of works. The rest of them don't, and that's why I'm the host, and they're fucking wrong. But we'll get there.
But Bond basically says to Silva, I have a radio, haha. And the troops literally come flying in.
Yep. And he gets captured.
And we're introduced to the very X-Men kind of prison.
Well, this is where I was really getting into, oh, okay, this movie is The Dark Knight, and Silva is the Joker. It's the exact same as the Joker in the holding cell, down to the same color as when he and Batman are beating each other up in that interrogation room.
Mm-hmm.
Silva is facially deformed, not quite the way the Joker was, but a very similar way, and he's crazy, and then it just kept building from there. There's scenes like in The Dark Knight where Silva's disguised as a cop so he can commit murder on a public figure. He's got the same sort of military precision planning. Even his hair's kind of the same. It's just, it's not green, but it's very long and stringy.
I never made the connections watching it.
Well, that's because
it's easy to say that it's perhaps not cribbed from it, but it's inspired by it.
Yeah.
Well, and Daniel has a spinoff podcast called Daniel Ruins Everything coming up. We're still working on a title.
Yes. That's as good a title as I've heard yet.
But I mean, the thing is, though, he's not wrong. I mean, what, Dark Knight comes out 3 years before this, 2 years before this?
4 years before this.
And I mean, it's not wrong. It's a good movie, but here's the thing about Silva and the Joker that I think work. I mean, the idea that someone could plan out something 5, 20, 30, 50 years in advance belongs to two people. DC villains and Batman villains.
Bond villains.
This Bond is kind of Batman, but yeah. You know what I mean.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, the idea that someone has wronged you and, as I recall, left for dead, this is what it is.
Well, Bond, even the overall plot of this is very similar to The Dark Knight. It's pretty much, okay, some deformed psychopath is targeting an institution that I feel a need to protect, but I'm not sure if it cares a lot about me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I do like that Silva is not only physically deformed, like the Two-Face kind of character, but he has one goal, destroy M. And he realizes that to get to M, he has to do a bunch. Now, we'll get to it eventually, but it ends with Home Alone. And there's this kind of like, well, what was your stage one plot? Because it obviously gets to stage five. It gets to your D plot. But like, this whole idea is like, but what if you just had killed M here? Or here? Because like at one point when MI5 blows up, MI5 or MI6?
MI6.
MI6. Thank you. MI6 blows up. There's this moment that, like, everything blows up, but then she gets this call. She, like, your schedule had been hacked. He knew you wouldn't be there. You were just supposed to arrive to see it.
It's a power play.
It's a power play, but it's also kind of like, who's in control, right? Because M is always God. Mm-hmm. Like you said, it's Bosley from, Blazing Saddles.
Well, I think the idea behind this is he wanted to kill her as she's making a testimony about whether or not the 00 program is still needed. So it wasn't just killing her randomly, because if she died in that explosion, she'd probably be considered a martyr.
Yeah.
In this case, he wanted to publicly humiliate her and realize you were never in control. control, I was always going to be above you.
Well, and to your point, the person that Silva is was someone who died, as she thought, in Hong Kong. So there's this, not unlike the CIA, a wall of stars where you're like, you had died. So you get your name on the wall. We don't explain what you did, but you're gone. Or is it the FBI who does it? Whatever.
Yeah. I think both do it.
But M has a line, I guess we have one name to remove from the wall.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Not even like, how dare you? Just like, I guess you're not dead. You don't matter anymore. It's very flippant, but it's kind of like, this is why Judi Dench is awesome. She's, because, is it, the world is not enough that she gets kidnapped?
Yes.
Yeah.
There she's like, I'll MacGyver my way out of it. No, no, no. Here she's just a character who just fucking figures it out, which is kind of great. She's just a strong-jawed woman who's just like, well, I don't give a shit for you.
Yeah, well, I mean, she views these people as basically line items on a dossier.
Well, and
well, that's how Silva would have you believe it.
Yeah. Right. Well, and to her character, she makes a decision to send an agent to do something. They succeed, they fail. She made the decision. They did the best they could. That's what it is. He failed in his mission. She regrets that, but not that he's still alive. Ooh, no, no, no. That was the mission.
I thought it was funny when, I forget which character said it to him, but like, you're getting sentimental about Bond. It's like, eh, she essentially ordered the agent to shoot him. Like, I don't know about that.
Yeah. but it's true. Yeah. Like,
but at the same time, when Bond first meets her, after he came back from the dead,
yeah,
she says, I had to make a call. And he says, you should have trusted me to finish the job.
But the one person he doesn't blame is Moneypenny, because their first interaction...
He took the shot. Yeah.
He took the shot. He's still like, I guess next time they'll need to be a better aim. Like,
or goes, if you're back in the field, I don't want to be back in the field.
Right, exactly.
It's like, he was like, it is harder to hit a moving target.
Yeah, he doesn't care, because she's another agent to him. Like, that was the most believable, because again... Yeah.
She followed orders.
And Moneypenny's the boss, or M's the boss, and... Mm-hmm. He gave him, like,
he would have done the same thing. You know he would have.
He would have, absolutely. And that's why he returned. Because he realizes no one made a bad decision. It's why I think Mission Impossible is a different movie. Because Mission Impossible, he essentially goes rogue and stays rogue. Mm-hmm. Bond always returns because it's still for Queen and Country. Mm-hmm. Which we kind of like. I don't know. It's
always for something bigger.
Yeah. I don't know. I guess we should speed up.
Okay. Jailbreak.
Impressive jailbreak.
The tech stuff.
Yeah.
No.
It's always...
He magicked his way out of prison.
He had the Lycos logo.
You know what? I don't mind his prison break. Because he knew where they were going to go. It's not the craziest thing. He makes doors open.
Yes.
But the whole, like, map of London, cryptograph...
That looks like the IBM Watson logo that just spins around. That's weird.
Yeah. But he magicked his way out. He goes into the hearing with M, and he shoots the place up. He injures Mallory, and that's about the only person he kills other than some cops.
Yeah. Bond and a bunch of people on a subway that he explodes.
Yeah, Bond...
There wasn't anyone on the car, were there?
I thought there were.
I didn't see anyone.
Regardless.
Because I was thinking, man, it's a good thing that train was empty.
There was a chase through the London Underground with Silva getting to ride the tube up to where M was, and there's this scene where he takes like the sewer routes, and he had somehow had a bomb in there that he blew up.
I guess he didn't feel the need to show a train full of people going off the edge and dying.
Yeah,
that would have cost a lot more money to plan and do.
Pay all their families
CG,
off.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But but regardless, they do it. M is saved. Silva runs off. Bond takes M, it kidnaps her, basically, and runs off and says, I'm taking you off the grid. We need to escape somewhere he can't figure us out. So he gets in the DB5, which is non-chipped, and they run up to Scotland. Meanwhile, telling Q, leave a trail of breadcrumbs.
Yeah.
Because we want only him to find where we're going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and specifically, it was like, we've been behind him the entire time. Let's get ahead of him.
Let's get ahead of him.
And this is where the movie turns into Home Alone.
Yeah. Well, Straw Dogs. Let's be a little classier.
Home Alone's more fun.
And I actually really liked... I know you guys are all saying it's Home Alone. I like this.
I like this sequence a lot more.
I just choose to compare it to another movie, but I liked it too.
It would have been more fun with Sean Connery as the gamekeeper.
Yeah, okay, so he shows up at Skyfall. We get this kind of pan through the highlands where it's all foggy. Bond looks wistfully as though not unlike... Well, I mean, we didn't reference this, but Silva has hacked into his records, and as we all kind of mentioned before, he didn't pass pass any of the tests, but M decided to approve him anyway because she feels like he's a good agent, which is what we're supposed to get from the earlier Bond movies, but this is the first time that M has actually backed Daniel Craig's Bond.
Mm-hmm.
So we get to the Highlands, and for the first time, like John pointed out, we get Skyfall, but we get why Skyfall means so much to him.
Yep.
It's the home where he was when his parents died, but he has no attachment to it because not only did they die, it just, he had nothing for them. He feels not close to them. He feels like his formation is at Cambridge, and that was a rough formation anyway. They show up, they open the door, and an old Scottish gamekeeper busts down the door.
It's Albert Finney, and he's fantastic.
And we get this pitch that the rumor, at least, the IMDb Tribune said that this was supposed to be Sean Connery, which he never, ever, ever, ever would have done.
Well, they did. According to the Tribune, they didn't even ask him because Sam Mendes decided that would be too distracting.
It probably would,
yeah, would it have been. Yeah. Yeah.
And he would have had to be like way too much of a badass to be the gamekeeper. So, I mean, he did have a sawed-off shotgun, but
yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, I do like the kind of charm that he's like. I think Daniel Craig's line is like, there are people after us. He goes, all right.
What was his line when they first showed up and he realizes that Kincaid's still there? What does Kincaid say?
Well, he goes, Master Bond, it's good to see you. And he goes, I thought you were dead or something.
Something like that, yeah.
It's good. I mean, I don't know. I like Kincaid. But he sees Judi Dench and he's like, essentially, he's not flirting, but he's like, Mom, are you okay?
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, no, we have a job to do, effectively. And they go to the game room, and there's no guns left because they were all sold except for old hunting rifle, one shotgun, and then Bond's sidearm. And then you might as well play, like you said, Home Alone, or I was thinking the A-Team theme, just like,
They come up with some fun gadgets.
Yeah, I liked it a lot.
I liked the shotgun shells in the chandelier.
Yeah, that was very practical stuff.
Well, and this is the closest that M, who I imagine, is based on.
She's breaking light bulbs and making shrapnel.
Well, it reminds me of Mallory Archer from Archer. Like, she's just like, if we're going to go to the old, like, World War II ways, I'm fucking there, man. Like, cause she's like breaking light bulbs, filling the base with shotgun shells. So when they turn on the lights, they just start shooting shrapnel at people.
And it's not just shrapnel; it's nails.
It's nails. It's a pipe bomb. Yeah. She makes a pipe bomb out of a chandelier.
She just has to flip a switch. Boom. And they put shotgun shells under the floorboards, so when they step on the floorboards, it explodes.
Yeah, I liked it.
Mm-hmm.
I liked this scene so much. Like, I really did. And it's old school spycraft, but it's also like Home Alone. No one died, which they should.
They should have many times over.
That's what happens, like in every local newspaper every winter. They're like, yeah, many times would they have? It's like a goddamn BuzzFeed article.
Yeah,
but so here nice. It's much more practical. It's just like people are going down, and it's kind of fun.
It's like my wife joined in watching the movie after the montage of them putting the thing together, and we see all the bad guys moving toward the house, and she says, "Those are a lot of bad guys. What are they going to do?" just watch it.
Yeah.
And they make mincemeat out of these guys.
Yeah.
And even the backup, they make mincemeat out.
Well, then they show up with a helicopter, and the helicopter, of course, gets brought down, but it's like the one moment when they're like, this is it. You guys have to go. Bond's there by himself. Like, Bond takes out the kerosene, or it's probably propane canisters. Mm-hmm. And it's just kind of like they have this, what they call the priest hole. What is it?
It was like a priest tunnel or something that they could.
I think it was called the priest hole.
Yeah.
It refers back to Mary Queen of Scots when the Protestants took back over. It's not for the boys that they were hiding.
What practical use does the priest have?
For a while.
When the Catholics were made illegal, they were killing priests.
Yeah.
That's why they call her Bloody Mary.
You need to make a quick exit out of the house.
Gotcha.
And so it's a tunnel, basically an escape tunnel.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it was most likely used during World War One than the priests, but that's what they used to call them when they were trying to smuggle out the Catholics.
And it unfortunately leads really close to the chapel, which would be the second place that Mary Queen of Scots would look for.
I would assume it was retrofitted as a chapel, and back in the day when they were actually using it, it was like looked like a barn or something.
It looks pretty fancy.
To your point, they end in a chapel. This isn't yet, because you have a bunch of people, Kincaid and M escaping via a back tunnel system, and ending up in a field, and after everything blows up.
Because of course.
Because Bond leaves the yes, but of course.
Because it's Bond. Everything blows up.
This is also where we get the heartbreaking scene where the DB5 is turned to dust.
Yep.
He blows everything up.
But then we have a maniacal laugh from Silva, who's literally just tossing grenades like a last boss of a movie.
Like the Joker.
Yeah. He turns out to the side, like laughing to himself, and then he sees a flashlight off in the distance. That's when the house blows up, and that's where everyone starts running towards the end boss. Right? The helicopter even explodes because Bond blows up a helicopter because he's got a bigger penis, I guess. I don't know. But they're all running to the chapel, at which point Silva is literally holding M, who's bleeding to death. Kincaid comes in and goes, "It's not your core, young man."
Now, how did M... Did she get shot?
Yeah, she was shot by one of the heavies.
One of the heavies hits her, and then she turns and shoots him, but that's when she starts bleeding.
And we're not really shown exactly where she was shot, but, like,
She reaches underneath the overcoat and pulls out a hand filled with blood. Like,
it's usually not a good sign.
No.
And he says, like, Silva says to something like, "It's like, mother, are you shot? Are you injured? You know, let's go out together. Let's just do this together." And he puts his head next to her head,
and he gives her the gun.
Yeah, gives her the gun and points it at both their head. Just one bullet, we'll both go down. Which is a very impactful scene. It shows just how crazy he is and what he saw.
And M, of course, as is appropriate, has nothing to say, right? Literally nothing to say. This is where Mendes either makes himself or breaks himself as a director. I think this is a very effective scene.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, speaking of Batman, it's not Dark Knight. It's the first Batman where they end in a church.
Yeah.
But this is a scene where he is in this ancient Scottish chapel, right? And Bond, who gives no shit for any of this religion stuff, but it is a very symbolic scene of the Mother Mary next to her forgotten son. Like, this is amazing. And yet, what? Someone describe this.
It's called symbolism.
Right. Well, but this is Mendes, man. Like, this is someone who had a Kevin Spacey in love with a teenage girl, and there's just roses coming out of her boobs. Like, this is... Mm-hmm. He's not subtle. He's not a subtle man.
Well, I was kind of disappointed by this ending, because if anybody needed a classic Bond death, it's Silva. But instead, Bond shows up right before M gets the shot off through both their heads and just throws a knife into Silva's back. And he turns around, tries to take a few steps forward, but collapses.
I thought it was very much like, we're taking this back to our roots. It's very gritty. Like, we're running across a frozen lake to a chapel, and I kill him with a knife.
Yeah,
and it makes him more of a sympathetic character too. It goes along with that Silva, he's the bad guy, but he was also a very wrong person.
So it's like the death of the Frankenstein monster.
If I may
say that, yeah.
If I may quote a song from a Mel Brooks play, The Producers, the song "Betrayed." "I thought you were my brother, but you stabbed me in the back." Bond literally throws a knife through his back when they're having an argument over their mother. For Christ's sake, this is the most Oedipal complex point. Because again, we didn't reference it, but in the last 100 yards before they get to the chapel is a frozen pond, as you referenced. Bond, fighting a heavy, falls through the ice, kills the heavy, and ends up in the chapel half frozen to death, which is why Silva gets the head start.
Hey, more Oedipal stuff. Bond in water, reemerging all wet.
Mm-hmm. He's reborn, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Bond ends up... But M is unsavable, right? It's only to see Silva die before she dies, right? That he is the one who ends the saga, but she has to live just a second longer. I think it's well done. And Bond, this is the only woman that we see Bond cry over. Because
mm-hmm.
Bond is holding her as she dies in a, like, the pieta pose. Like, he is cradling her.
I don't know about ever. I mean, wife...
No. I'm saying Daniel Craig.
Oh, okay.
Because Daniel Craig
doesn't care.
He loves Vesper, but when she turns on him, we don't see her shed tears.
Yeah.
He sheds tears for him.
Yeah.
We see the tear run down his cheek and land on him, which we don't see. He does. Daniel and I, actually, when we watched this together afterwards, talked about that. Like, on Her Majesty's Secret Service, that might be the most heartbreaking scene ever.
Yes.
She's just sleeping as the cop asks them if they're okay. That is atrocious.
Yeah.
Holy.
It's tragic. And likewise with this, it goes back to the mother symbolism or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
She was the mother to Bond. Even she makes a point when they move into Skyfall that we like getting orphans because they're the best to train. They don't have the background. They're the best. And she becomes the mother to them.
Well, and when his family home is destroyed, he says, I always hated this place. He's upset about the car, but he only cries for M, which is interesting because then when we get Ralph Fiennes as the new M, because his last name is Mallory, mm-hmm. We don't ever know what Judi Dench's name is, but he holds up like a piece of mail from her house in the last movie, and he goes.
At one point, said Emma.
Yes,
I think he was just hearing M.
Okay,
yeah,
and thinks Emma.
Oh, you're not wrong. I thought the same thing. Yeah. I looked at Daniel and go,
I mean,
Bob, he wouldn't have known her, so it didn't make sense.
Right.
I think it was in Casino Royale when Bond had rifled through her stuff. He said, I always thought M was just a title. I didn't know it went with the name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Utter one more syllable and I'll have you killed.
Exactly. Yeah.
I don't know. But then when we get to Ralph Fiennes, that's the M relationship that we get where he's just another guy who Bond has to deal with. But it's a very straight jawed kind of like, mm-hmm. you know, it's a one, but it's a back and forth.
You very much come around on Mallory by the end of the movie because, like, mm-hmm. they're setting the trail of breadcrumbs or whatever, and it's like, well, what happens if the PM finds out? And he's like, then we're all buggers. So, yeah. One of the guys.
And he was one of the guys that saved M in the shootout.
Yes.
He picks up someone's sidearm and just starts shooting back.
Well, and mm-hmm. during the trial or whatever you want to call it, he's like, can we let the witness talk?
I mean,
well, I think there's a begrudging respect between the two because, again, he obviously admired her because he just thought she was no longer capable of doing the job properly.
Well, and he doesn't kick her out. He offers her a drink. It's very much the game that they always play, right? But I don't know. I think he's an interesting character because by the time we get to the next movie, he's the one effectively on trial.
Yeah.
Because I get I forget the actor, Moriarty from Sherlock.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is just the new guy with the tech and he's just going to fix it all because it's, I guess Sam Mendes hates the fact that he got caught on, I don't know, Zanga or something with personal thoughts. I don't know, but it's all tech from then on out. And they're all old people who are out of date. They're all dinosaurs, as mm-hmm. M says to Pierce Brosnan. I kind of like this ending because not only does M take over and he has his leather door and he offers Bond a drink and a file and Moneypenny is there, so it feels like a familiar old pair of pants, right? Like it's back mm-hmm. to Bond being deformed.
I just love the beginning of that when you see her, I think, take her coat off and she has like the blue dress on. Mm-hmm. She's like, I see what's going on.
Yeah, right away. And she's at a computer instead of a typewriter, but mm-hmm. she's right there at the desk. Yep. And Ralph Fiennes, and I think they even had the repartee where he's like, I thought you were going back to the field. She goes, no, you're right, it's too dangerous.
Yeah, she said, it's not for everyone.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And
they were on the roof. What is the dog from? Is the porcelain dog from?
It was on
her desk earlier, but is that the first time in the whole sequence of the movies that we ever see that dog?
No, because as you referenced in Casino Royale, when Bond breaks into her house, it's on the desk there as well.
Okay.
And so
it's not a callback from a really old movie where M at some point had a porcelain like Union Jack dog.
I
think it's just supposed to symbolize it's one of those kitschy things everyone has on their desk.
Yeah, especially in government service, since it's the Churchill symbol.
Yeah.
And of course, Bond is someone who, of anything else, hates to be on a desk, and that was the line.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I guess M wants you to be on a desk, too, and he goes, no, just the opposite.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? I don't know. I like kind of how this ends, and then
We get
the gun barrel scene. And we get Bond being issued a new mission where he literally gets a folio thrown across his desk that says, you know, secret mission for your It's only 007.
Lots of work to be done, which is a very classic M, like mm-hmm. old M line.
Yeah, I mean, and if it were any other movie, of course, it'd be the first 15 minutes mm-hmm. after the musical open. But here it's just, look, the work continues even without M. And it's interesting because it's twofold. You hold a candle for Judi Dench, who does an excellent job, who literally dies on the job, but there's work to be done.
Yep.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Beautifully well done. So, around the horn. Best Bond film or greatest Bond film? No. Matt, what do you want to start with?
I like this one a lot. I liked it a lot at the time. Even it was getting a lot of flack, and I can't remember the exact reasons, but a lot of people were saying they didn't like it for XYZ reasons. They didn't think it was good. And there are really only like one or two things that actually bother me about this movie. It's the tech mumbo jumbo.
The Heineken.
The Heineken. There you go. I just think it was the 50th anniversary. I think they did it very, very well. Mm-hmm. And I just really like some of the traditional spycraft stuff that they bring back to basics. And it's very like gritty and practical and like, I'm going to kill these guys. I'm going to save the day. And if I can't, then I'm going to mourn and move on. I don't know. I like it a lot. It's one of my favorites. So.
No, fair to you. John.
Likewise. And I loved how there weren't just explosions for explosion's sake. There weren't really chases for chase's sake, which, as we'll get into, the next movie goes back to all that. Yeah. That it was Bond has issued a gun and a radio, and that's what he has to work with in the field. And I like it. It was back to some spycraft. It was back to just simplicity. It was a good story that ran at a good clip.
Yep.
And I like how they introduced what we'll get into in the next movie, which is basically a team.
Yeah.
You got M, Money, Penny, and Q helping Bond, not just in an ancillary kind of way, but he needs them to do his job.
Yeah.
And I'm glad you brought up the pacing, because we hadn't really talked about that. I thought it was really on point. I didn't think there was any lulls in particular. So
it slowed down a bit, I think, when Silva was captured.
A little bit.
Yeah, but, you know, it was pretty well paced. I liked it.
Agreed.
I remember when this first came out, and my memory was different from yours, Matt, because I just remember everybody praising it, and it had like a 97% on Rotten Tomatoes.
For some reason, I remember people kind of like shitting on it.
No, I don't remember that.
No, I mean, you're not wrong. I'll get to you, too.
Okay.
Well, I when I first saw it, I'm sort of like, huh, that was good, but I don't see why everybody's praising it as much as they are. I thought the villain was a little too derivative, too much of the focus was on M, not enough on Bond. Watching it again, though, I liked it a lot better than I did at the time. It's grown on me for the reasons you guys mentioned. It's very well paced. It's got a bunch of great acting. I don't think we mentioned the fact that there's like, what, four Oscar nominees in this cast?
Yeah.
But, and I think if you want to introduce anybody to like Bond and his world, this would be one of the places you can start.
Yeah.
This really, really helps explain his character.
I hadn't thought about that from that perspective, but yeah, you're not wrong. It's good on, not only good on Bond, but
it's probably the most character backstory we've gotten in a Bond movie so far ever.
Yeah.
Probably. Yeah.
We don't get his, like, I think John brought up, we have his apartment once before, but we don't get a lot of Bond, like, who he is. And they try that a lot with Daniel Craig. I don't know. I liked it at first. I think the results were mixed, not only because, yes, you're right, it had like a 90 something on Rotten Tomatoes, at least at first. I don't know where it ended, but
yeah,
the Bond people really didn't. God, everyone has a fucking opinion on Bond movies, don't they? I mean, I don't know, like Wonder Woman now too, just this, based on when we're recording this, but I think Bond fans didn't like it for the Heineken. They didn't like it for the name drops. I think this is actually pretty subtle on fan service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, compared to Die Another Day. Oh, my God.
Oh, my. I thought we weren't talking about
that. We're not talking about that anymore. No. I just bring that up.
I mean, but Daniel Craig is functional in this world, but barely. I like the fact that Bond seems sometimes behind the eight ball, but then he has to get it back. It's not like Roger Moore, who just is like, has no idea, and then blissfully finds the plot.
Yeah.
Right.
He's getting left behind, but there are moments where they display how good he is at what he does.
He does. I mean, and they don't focus on anything. Like, this is another movie where he could have been spending half an hour playing a game of gamble, but he doesn't. He cashes the chip, wins one game just to be next to the person who he needs to find, and then she's the one who forwards the plot. That's it. Like, Bond is someone who, when he realizes the plot, feels more desperate because he needs to get ahead of it. It's not like the world is going to be destroyed, but he's like, no, like, for reasons that are just, she's another part of this mission, I can't let M die. that matters. This is a very interesting movie in that way, mm-hmm. because when I first watched it, it wasn't that I thought it was too dark. I just, it was long and there was plotting. No. This moves at a nice clip. And you're right. I hadn't thought of that, but this is almost better than Casino Royale in introducing the character. Mm-hmm. I love Casino Royale, but it's a much more like, now they're going to play poker for 45 minutes.
Yeah, I was actually disappointed going back and watching it. I wouldn't say I was disappointed.
Yeah.
But it wasn't the most, like, there. It's a great movie. I like it a lot. They did sit and play poker a lot.
Well, it's a better movie than it is a Bond movie. This is a better Bond movie than a regular movie.
Go watch the Casino Royale they made in the 60s with Woody Allen.
I never watched it.
That's Casino Royale.
Yeah, that one. Oh, man.
We'll watch it when we're
done. Yeah, we'll have to watch it. It's special.
And if you guys are interested, we'll do an episode on it. We'll regret it, but we'll do it. However, I would say we should watch it. You should watch it. I'll revisit it. I'll be honest. I hadn't rewatched it since it came out because I wanted to watch the old ones after seeing this. I actually enjoy this much more than a lot of the old ones than I expected, especially. But regardless, we're out of time. So tune in next month when not only we'll be ending the series, at least on the Myopia feed. We're talking about doing some mission briefing stuff on the mission briefing feed only. Tune in and let us know if you want to do that. Email us. But we'll be ending this series as it stands for now with Spectre. Of course, though, I promise, when they come out with a new Bond movie, we'll be right back on these microphones, ladies and gentlemen. So tune in for Daniel Craig's finale as it exists right now with Spectre. Thanks, everyone.
Mission Briefing and Myopia Defender Childhood are produced by Dude Letter Podcasting. It's hosted and edited by Nick Hoffmann. Our graphic designer is Scott Miller. The theme song is sampled from Monty Norman's James Bond theme. Questions and comments? Please visit myopiapodcast.com/missionbriefing or contact us through myopiamissionbriefing@gmail.com. You can follow us on Twitter @missionbriefing and @myopiapodcast. And find us on Facebook, Stitcher, and iTunes. And while you're on iTunes, please rate and review our podcast. Want to help us out? Go to myopiapodcast.com/Amazon and purchase stuff like normal. Myopia and Mission Briefing get a piece of the action. James Bond in Spectre.